Anil, can you make the elevator pitch for people who are already familiar with the argument that, look, the processing that's going on in our brain is just processing. It could potentially be translated to a computer. If consciousness is similarly information processing, then we have something that's quote unquote substrate independent. So you're making the claim that it's not so clear. Maybe there is a dependence to the substrate. Can you make that case? And then also, Michael, I know that you have several questions you'd like to ask Anil, and feel free at any point to.
I'll try and make it, but that's the case I'm trying to make. It's quite tricky because it goes against such a deeply embedded assumption that the brain is basically a computer made of meat, and the things that it does, the only things that it does that are relevant for things like cognition and consciousness are computations, are forms of information processing. If you start from that perspective, it leads you to this idea that there is this substrate independency. So that, and what that means to unpack that, that just means that the stuff we're made of doesn't really matter. It's the computations that matter. And if the substrate can implement computations, then fine. These two sort of ideas go together because one of the whole motivations for a computational view is substrate independency. Turing's formulation of computation is formulated in terms of it being independent of any particular material. So the elevator pitch really is that we've kind of forgotten that the idea of the brain as a computer is a metaphor and not the thing itself. It's a sort of marriage of mathematical convenience. And the closer you look at real biological systems, as Mike's work beautifully exemplifies, now, the less that this idea of substrate independency makes any real sense. There's no bright line in a brain or a biological system in general between what you might call the mindware and the wetware, between what it does and what it is. And if there's no clear way to separate in a system what it does from what it is, then it's very, very much less clear that one should think that computation is all that matters. Because for computation to be all that matters, you kind of have to have the sharp separation between the software and the hardware, the what it does and what it is. And if you can't do that, then there's less reason to think that computation is what matters. And if there's less reason to think that, then there's equally less reason to think that you could implement what matters in a substrate independent way on something else. You can, of course, still use computers to simulate a brain in whatever level of detail you want. But that's neither here nor there. It's a very useful thing to do. We both do this. We do this all the time. But you can simulate anything using a computer. That's one reason computers are great. But that doesn't mean you will instantiate the phenomenon. You only do that if computation really is all that matters. And I think that's very much up. I think it's been a very deeply held assumption, but I think it's likely wrong.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with everything Anil said, but I take it in a slightly different direction. So I think it's critical to remember that, everything we think about as computation is a metaphor. It's a formal model. And so we have to ask ourselves, what does this model help us do? And what is it hiding? In other words, what is it preventing us from seeing? And I agree that this metaphor, it does not capture everything that we need to know about, and we need to use to do technology and so on about life. I think the computational paradigm and the notion of algorithms and so on does not capture everything we need to know about life. But I make the additional really weird claim is that I don't think it captures everything we need to know about machines either. In other words, we tend to think, at least the people I meet tend to think that we have this set of metaphors that are for machines and their algorithms. And they don't really apply to biology. Certainly people say, well, they don't apply to me. I'm creative and whatever else, you know, they are. But there is a corner of the universe that is boring, mechanical. It only does what the algorithm says it should do. And for those kinds of things, you know, these metaphors are perfect. They capture everything there is to know. So I agree with Anil on the first part, but I doubt the second part. I think that a lot of what we have in our theories of computation is a pretty reasonable theory of what I call the front end. I think most of what we deal with are actually thin clients in a certain sense. their interfaces to something to something much deeper, which we can call the Platonic space. I don't love the name, but I say it that way because then at least the mathematicians know what I'm talking about. But I think that even and we have some work already published and more work coming soon in the next few months on this, showing that. Yeah, the standard way of looking at algorithms don't even tell the story of so-called machines. And so whatever it is, and I have guesses, but we don't know. Whatever it is that allows mind to come through biological interfaces and not be captured by these formal models, I think these other systems that we call machines and certainly cyborgs and hybrids and all this other stuff, I think they get some of the magic too. It's not going to be like us. It's going to be, you know, different, but I don't think they escape these ingressions either.
This is why I think I find Mike's work so interesting because it's provocative in this direction. I think he's, you know, I've always, I think he kind of summarizes what I said very well is that, I think we underestimate the richness of biological systems if you force them into the what's often called the machine metaphor, by which we really mean that all that matters is a sort of Turing computation algorithm thing. But I think it is equally true that we limit our imagination about what machines might be as well by doing this. And there's a whole kind of alternative history of AI, which was really grounded in 20th century cybernetics. There's much more to do about dynamical systems, attractors, feedback systems, all things you can still simulate computationally, which are fundamentally not sort of arising from that, the algorithmic way of thinking about things. There are also really interesting mathematical properties like emergence and so on, which I think apply to these, can both be help us understand, but also might be design principles for machines of various kinds, which again don't really fit into an algorithmic view of things. So Mike's work beautifully shows that even something we think of as canonically algorithmic, like, correct me if I'm wrong, Mike, but the bubble sort of stuff. So this is an algorithm that anyone in computer science 101 learns to code, to sort things into a particular order, has really interesting emergent properties that could be, that other things can be built on top of. So, yeah, I think it's, for me, it's like there's this nice iterative back and forth where we can learn to think of both biology and machines differently. And of course, that might give us richer metaphors through which we can use one lens to understand the other.
Would you say then that we have the idea of machine and that a Turing machine is a strict subset of that idea of machine?
I mean, a Turing machine is an abstraction, right? Turing machines were never sort of supposed to exist, you know, as things. They're infinite tape and things like that. So you've got, a Turing machine, the idea is you, in one sense, you're mapping a bunch of numbers onto another bunch of numbers. And then the universal Turing machine does this through this moving head and an infinite type. It was never really supposed to exist as a physical machine. And I think that's where part of the problem has sort of come from. But an algorithm in that sense, yeah, I think that's a subset. When you realize a Turing machine, that's a subset of possible machines.
Yes, when you realize a Turing machine, it will be a subset of all possible machines just because it's a particular Turing machine.
But, no, are but you when you realize a universal Turing machine as well, that's also in a subset of possible machines.
So if you don't mind spelling out to the audience the idea of hypercomputation, and would you then say that biological creatures or cells or what have you are doing something that is hypercomputational? And feel free to take this in a different direction, Michael, as well, if you like.
I'd love to say that, but would you give me what you're thinking of when you use the word hypercomputation? I've heard it used to imply different things.
So if something can solve the halting problem, it would be an example of a hypercomputer. Something that can decide problems that a Turing machine or a universal Turing machine can't.
Right, so sort of super Turing in some sense. That's one way in which machines can be non-Turing or can state Turing world. But there are many other systems that are just not captured by this way. They don't have to be based on the halting problem. Like, strictly anything that is stochastic, anything that is continuous, is beyond this world of strict universal Turing machines. There are kinds of extensions that try to go there. But there are also functions that things do that necessarily involve particular material substrates. So take something like metabolism. And metabolism is not mapping some range of numbers, whether they're continuous or random, to another number. It involves actual transformation of a particular kind of substance into another kind of substance. That's just non-Turing in what is a fairly trivial way. But that kind of thing might be very important for particular classes of machines or systems, whether they're biological or not. So I think there's different spaces of what you might call non-Turing processes. Only some of these are these kinds of hyper-computation, halting problem-solving things where you might say you've got some sort of, I don't know, fancy quantum stuff going on. But I think opinions differ about that. Opinions differ, right? I mean, there are some people that would say that unless you're talking about this hyper-computation, the sense you'd mentioned, that everything else is sort of a relatively feasible extension of Turing as is.
I'm a Roe partner, and I want to tell you about Roe Sparks, a 2-in-1 prescription treatment for men, for guys who want better performance. Roe Sparks dissolves under the tongue, hitting the bloodstream faster than old school pills. Once the medication dissolves, Roe Sparks works in 15 minutes on average. No more waiting when the mood is right. Plus, Roe Sparks dual action formula contains tadalafil, staying active in your system for up to 36 hours. You don't stay hard that whole time. It's just when aroused, your body can respond, ready for round after round. Roe connects guys with a medical provider, 100% online, no awkward in-person conversations, no waiting rooms. If approved, treatment ships directly to your door. If prescribed, new sexual health patients get $15 off your first order of Sparks on a recurring plan. Connect with a provider at roe.co/toe to find out if prescription Roe Sparks are right for you. That's roe.co/toe for $15 off your first order. Compounded drugs are permitted to be prescribed under federal law, but are not FDA approved and do not undergo FDA safety, effectiveness, or manufacturing review. For safety information, go to roe.co/safetyinfo.